So all of our cells have this amazing, all of our cells have this amazing system of antigen presentation on the cell surface by the HLA molecules or MHC molecules. Their function is to collect fragments of proteins or peptides inside the cell and bring them to the cell surface. And there these peptides can be recognized by T cells. And this is also the case for tumor-associated changes, including mutations, which have been mentioned a couple of times during this session. And the T cells, of course, can be killer cells, killing a cell, or inflammatory or helper cells, also able to attack tumors. And we also know that cancer cells differ from normal cells in gene expression. And all these changes can be sensed by T cells, and it's important to state here, based on this HLA antigen presentation system, no matter which cellular compartment is affected by the change, mutations in the nuclear or cytosolic protein, gene product, for example, this always can be sensed by T cells in principle. This is in contrast to antibodies, which only can recognize things expressed on the cell surface. Each tumor is different, we know that, and tumors also have usually acquired a large set of mutated genes. Depending on the tumor entity, there are more or less mutations found in the tumor. And all these mutations can be recognized in principle by T cells via peptide presentation on HLA molecules on the surface of these tumor cells. Like on the right-hand side, this would be a tumor cell with a mutated antigen on the cell surface presented by an MHC molecule. And this, of course, should be the ideal antigen for immunotherapy of cancer, because this mutated antigen is only on a tumor cell and not at all on any normal cell. Problem is that this attack of mutated antigens is only possible in an individualized approach if one thinks of specific attack. The antigens used so far, also in the previous talk by Philip, are of the overexpressed self type, so non-mutated peptides, overexpressed by the tumor cell, but not absent on normal cells. This is frequently used for vaccine approaches so far. We use it also in IMATIX for IMA901 and other multi-peptide cocktails. I will give an example on for colon carcinoma later on. And there is another set or class of interesting antigens which are not tumor-specific or associated at all. These are the tissue-specific antigens. They can be used for tissues or cell types which are not essential for life. So if a cancer arises from prostate, for example, or from a B-cell, in the case of B-cell leukemia, one can kill the entire prostate cells or the B-cells together with the cancer, and it doesn't kill the patient. So example is Provenge, as I mentioned, which is a single antigen vaccine against prostate cancer. And the established antibodies like rituximab against B-cell leukemias, recognizing CD20, a common B-cell antigen, are of this kind of tissue-specific antigens. And these antigens are also popular targets for CARs, for chimeric antigen receptor-mediated therapies. In the meantime, as also mentioned before, it is well recognized that the immune system can do something against cancer, as has been anticipated by Paul Ehrlich already. And impressive results of the checkpoint inhibitors inducing, in some patients, long-lasting remission of advanced melanoma lesions have convinced the community that there is something to immunotherapy of cancer. These checkpoint antibodies are connected with some toxicity, and the idea would be for the future to take these tumor-specific antigens, which are actually recognized by after checkpoint antibody treatment. These are usually mutations which are recognized, identified by correlation. The idea would be to find these specific antigens and mutations, and they should be good targets for molecular-defined cancer immunotherapy in the absence of toxicity. We can use many forms of antigens to do this. I will only speak on peptides and a little bit on RNA to be used as antigens for vaccination in cancer patients. our approach to find these antigens, which we have developed over the last couple of decades, I should say, we start with a piece of tissue of the tumor and a piece of tissue of the normal organ, always received from the surgery, from fresh tumor samples, fresh frozen tissue samples, prepare a tissue lysate, isolate the HLA molecules, remove the peptides from these molecules by immunoaffinity. Many of you have seen this. So this, the one hand is antibody and the other hand is trifluoroacetic acid, taking out the peptide from the HLA molecule. And this actually mixture of peptides, of 10,000 different peptides, is then separated by HPLC here, and then analyzed by mass spectrometry. And usually we find a couple of thousand peptides. The red bars indicate peptides found in the tumor, and the green bars found in the normal part. And typically, these are peptides derived from all kinds of cellular proteins, non-mutated so far. And these are the bars show the incidence of findings. So the more frequent such a peptide has been found, the more tumor specific we consider it. And these would be candidates for vaccination of this particular patient here. We have done this for a couple of hundred solid tumors, particularly renal cell carcinoma, but also others. And a point here to make is that all these non-mutated peptides, tumor-associated peptides, are expressed in a very patient-specific manner also. So the 6,000 peptides we found to be tumor-associated in a number of renal cell carcinomas. From these, only about 5% are found in more than half of the tumors of the patients. And very few of these peptides, only these three, are found in most of the tumors. So most of these even non-mutated tumor-associated peptides are expressed in a highly individualized fashion. Based on this work, we have done a couple of clinical studies. I picked out here the colorectal cancer study by Imatics, one of our spin-offs. This was a study, I think I can skip this part, was a study using 13 tumor-associated non-mutated peptides from all kinds of antigens overexpressed in colon carcinoma samples. And these are peptides of the kind which are shared by several patients. So all patients, if they are HLA-A2 positive, receive this mixture of class 1 and class 2 peptides. This was the study design. A non-controlled phase 1-2 study with two arms of immunomodulation or adjuvants. And the vaccination was done first more frequently and then later on monthly. And important was that the immune monitoring was done in a very detailed fashion, allowing to analyze like this. So we found a number of T-cell responses. Actually, T-cell responses in most patients, recognizing one or two or even three or more of these peptides out of the list of 13 peptides. Also true for the three CD4 peptides. Most patients recognize against the CD4 peptides. Also the majority of patients recognized class 1 and class 2 peptides. And there was a little advantage of this cohort with the imiquimod, which is a TLR7 ligand. And this was why the immunomonitoring was so important. There was a tendency that the patients with a better immune response, these are always the upper curves for class 1 and class 2, and also class 1 and class 2 peptides, showed a trend for increased overall survival. So the better immune response against these peptides was correlated with a better survival. And also, Imatics did a number of biomarker studies. One of them was association of a kind of suppressor cells, myeloid-derived suppressor cells of different sorts. And for two of them, MDSC4 and 5 in this nomenclature, there was a negative correlation. The more of these suppressor cells were present, the lower was the overall survival of the patients. So we have seen from this, and actually there are several other studies also from others, showing that this kind of active immunotherapy vaccination with antigens can do some effect also by prolonging the life of the patients, but one learns also from these studies one should aim to have a stronger immune response. And this immune regulator, I did not mention, cyclophosphamide immunomodulator, appears to be useful, reducing the number of regulatory T cells, but much less efficiently than the checkpoint antibodies, ipilimumab, for example. And immunotherapy of this kind may not have much impact on progression-free survival, but on overall survival, and I should also add here, is usually associated with no severe toxicity. Now, in addition to peptides, one can use also messenger RNA for vaccination if the RNA is optimized for in vivo translation. Another spin-off of our university, CureVac, has developed messenger RNA vaccination. This is a phase 1/2 study completed in prostate cancer with prostate tissue-associated antigens, 4 of them. And this study has shown immunogenicity of this RNA vaccine in the majority of patients. There was also some correlation of the stronger immune response with clinical responses, and based on these results, a phase 2b trial has been started 2 years ago, almost 2 years ago, using six different RNA preparations from prostate cancer-associated antigens. Let's come to the question why mutated antigens should be the better targets. This has been discussed already before by Ugo Sahin. There are trivial arguments. One argument is that T cells having left the thymus before the tumor occurs cannot have central tolerance against the tumor-specific mutations. And Thomas Wölfel has shown, for example, that T cells against such mutations exist in patients. And thymic selection can only work, negative selection, on things which are there. If the antigen is not there, there can be no negative selection. And the second rather trivial argument is that T cells specific for tumor-specific mutations should be rather specific and not react to any cell structure, so as also illustrated by this picture on the very right. So our strategy to identify peptides has been changed a bit to find the mutated peptides. We do this by comparing our peptide analysis to genome and transcriptome sequence of tumor and normal material. And we have done this, we've started this a couple of years ago. This is an example of a cholangiocellular carcinoma patient. So what we see here are the different genes found to contain mutations by exome sequencing, actually. And what we did here is to look for peptides predicted to be presented by the HLA molecule of this particular patient. We can do this by algorithms predicting HLA presentation, which we had developed. And in this particular patient, we found more than 80 peptide sequences fitting to the HLA specificities of this patient. And then we tried to verify the presence of these peptides on the tumor tissue of this patient by mass spectrometry. And I can summarize a large deal of work. We failed so far to find such mutated peptides in human solid tumors by validated mass spectrometry. We did find peptides mutated with the right predicted mass and with a fitting fragmentation pattern, but we could not validate the mutated peptide by a synthetic isotope-labeled peptide. We could do this in collaboration with Bob Schreiber, with Heiko Schuster, PhD student of Stefan Stefanowitz's lab. We could do this in a mouse system, in Bob Schreiber's mouse system. So that's the way it should look like. This is a peptide from the tumor, and the synthetic peptide isotope-labeled shows exactly the same mass spectrometry fragmentation pattern. So in this case, we are confident that the peptide on a tumor has this sequence. And this we could not achieve so far for peptides from human solid tumor tissue, also from human tumors in general. So we failed so far to find such mutated peptides in human tumors. But we know, of course, that they are there. This is shown very clearly by T-cell data. So why is it so hard to find mutated peptides on the human tumor tissue, taken directly from the patient, not cell lines, by mass spec? There are probably two reasons. One is that we just have insufficient sensitivity in our mass spec. Also, we find now 3,000 or 5,000 peptides per tumor sample in a small sample. But the second reason might be also that there is probably negative selection of tumor cells expressing immunogenic mutated peptides as HLA ligands, and we are presently started a research program funded by the ERC to analyze these, the last question. So since we have seen that it's harder than we expected to find mutated HLA ligands as peptides, not as exome sequences, we amended our strategy. So we now think for individualized immunotherapy, we first take non-mutated off-the-shelf peptides, which we know in large numbers. We have a database of several hundred thousand peptides from different tumor entities, so we can take them, we could prepare them off the shelf and use them very short after surgery, for example, for vaccination. And in the second step, we, after successful tumor mutation analysis, we would vaccinate with the mutated peptides. There is one problem, that these peptides have to be produced according to GMP conditions, as has been mentioned by Ugo for RNA. So to make it short, we do have Herstellungserlaubnis after 7 years of work since earlier of this year, so we can produce these peptides now for the individualized vaccination. This is our Herstellungserlaubnis, done mainly by Stefan Stefanovic and his girls. And the other problem Ugo also has dealt with, what will the regulatory authorities say to an individualized study design? The answer is yes, go on. And we do this now in collaboration with BioNTech and Mainz in a glioma study. So the idea is here that for each patient, a separate peptide vaccine is produced. And the regulatory rules allow this so far. And this is our collaborators in this glioma vaccination studies. And the strategy is here that rather than looking for peptides which are shared by many patients, to look for the individual peptides expressed by the individual tumor of a patient and give these peptides as off-the-shelf peptides in the first step, right, short after operation of the patient, and later on when we have done the mutation analysis, come back with or give the mutated peptides as a second vaccine. So we will see whether this is feasible and whether this is successful. And this is this is a process. You see that there are several steps, and we hope that in beginning of 2015, we can have the first patient in. So in general, this is my last slide before the acknowledgements. Our strategy is now start vaccination of a patient with off-the-shelf peptides selected for this particular patient, and then in the second step, select patients representing mutated and also patient-specific non-mutated peptides in a cocktail, and do a second step of vaccination. These are the people involved from Immatics and BioNTech for the CAPVAX study and Immatics for the colocarcinoma study. These are the people involved, collaborators in my department in Tübingen and of the University Hospital. And the last picture shows the people who really did the work which I have presented. Thank you for your attention.
Thanks a lot for this really nice presentation. I was wondering, have you checked spontaneous or pre-existing T-cell responses that correlate with the epitopes you elude from tumors? So the highest presented epitopes or the most tumor-specific epitopes you identify, are they frequently recognized?
We have done this recently. We have started to do this rather recently. In leukemias, in AML and in CLL, and to my surprise, we indeed found that the most evident tumor-associated peptides, those with the best tumor association, showed T-cell response in the particular patient. And even more surprising, if one does this for more patients, this is work of Juli Stickel from the hematology department in Tübingen. To my additional surprise, looking back, there was a correlation with the survival time of these patients showing T-cells against these peptides we identify by mass spec. Mm-hmm. These are very recent data, not yet published.
Mm-hmm. Peter?
Jörg, I couldn't see that because we flashed it relatively quickly. The control groups you had in your clinical studies, what kind of control groups were there?
There was no control group.
There was no control group.
What has been done in a colorectal study, which I think took out, was a historical control, which looked actually very favorable, the immunotherapy. But this study is was not being controlled. In the renal cell carcinoma study, we had two arms, one with and without an immunomodulator, cyclophosphamide, and the arm with immunomodulator looked much better. And a phase 3 study in renal cell carcinoma is presently running, and we are very excited to see the data in 2015 when they will be unlocked and open. But so far, no controlled vaccination study has been done by us.
Two questions, please. The first, would you consider using messenger RNA and peptide cocktail in treatment?
We never mixed peptide and messenger RNA. But we will. What is the question?
Would you consider it? I mean, would you consider
it? But now
using
we do it. We are planning a trial with peptide vaccination, but using a kind optimized kind of messenger RNA as an adjuvant. This is RNA adjuvant from CureVac, which has been optimized to be a TLR7 ligand, and this we are planning. But so far we have not mixed RNA and peptides for coding RNA with peptides.
Okay, the other question is, would you include a microRNA somehow with the messenger RNA construct of your vaccine to enhance the cell's ability to introduce or express the antigens that are already present?
If you can tell me a microRNA doing this, we can consider this.
I mean,
but I did not think of this so far.
I don't see any other questions, so thanks again.